Welcome to the screencast in which we discuss random vectors. As we have seen for pairs of random variables, often we need to combine multiple random variables in order to describe a random process. Multiple random variables which are associated to the same random process are called joint random variables. For joint random variables, we need to build a probability model that contains both the properties of the individual random variables as well as the relationship between them. An example where it is useful to consider multiple random variables is the measurement of the electrical activity of the brain performed by an EEG measurement. This is done by placing multiple electrodes on the scalp, and each of these electrodes records the electrical activity on a different channel. Each of these channels can be considered as a different random variable. Random vectors provide a convenient way to describe multiple random variables. Basically, random vectors group multiple random variables in a compact form using matrix notation. Here, for example, we can group random variables representing each of the n EEG channels as a column vector. As notation, we typically write in bold the random vector and note in bold all the single random variables, while the symbol T represents the transpose. When we look at a single realization of this random vector, then we use lowercase letters. Random vectors are also convenient to combine random variables from different sources. Suppose that now we have an additional measurement such as an ECG, which is also derived from multiple electrodes. Here again, we can think as the signal from each electrode as a different random variable. By using random vectors, we can easily combine these two measurements. For example, if we have the random vector X containing all EEG measurements and the random vector Y containing all ECG measurements, the random vector Z containing both measurements is the least of these random variables. However, by using random vectors, we can simplify the notation by expressing Z as the concatenation of X and Y. Now that we have multiple random variables, we need multivariate probability distributions. The joint CDF for multiple random variables can be seen as an extension of the joint CDF for pairs of random variables. Here, the random vector notation also comes in handy, as we can avoid listing all the variables and simply use the bold notation. Very similarly, we can obtain the joint PMF and the joint PDF as straightforward extensions of the case for pairs of random variables. As for pairs of random variables, marginalization is a useful operation where we want to obtain the probability model of one or more random variables of interest. For example, if we have available the joint PMF of n random variables and we want to obtain the joint PMF of only x2 and x3, we simply need to sum the full model over all other variables that are not of interest. And in the case of continuous random variables, the summation simply becomes an integral. In probability theory, we introduced the concept of independence. Two events are said to be independent if one event has no influence on the outcome of the other. Now we can extend the concept of independence to probability functions. N random variables can be regarded as independent when their joint PMF is given by the product of the PMFs of the single random variables. To verify this in practice, we can look once again at the example of rolling two dice. We had found that the joint probability model of D1 and D2 was equal to 1 over 36 for any D1 and D2 in the range. Suppose that now I want to calculate the probability of D1 being equal to 4 and D2 being equal to 3. Since D1 and D2 are independent roles, then it is sufficient that I multiply the probability of D1 equal 4 by the probability of D2 equal 3. Although in this simple case these probabilities are easy to calculate, in general we can first use marginalization to obtain the two marginals PD1 and PD2. Then we can use these two marginals to calculate the probabilities that we need. We will multiply these we obtain indeed the probability we were looking for as 1 over 36. And we can repeat this for any D1 and D2, obtaining the same result. So with this we can confirm that indeed D1 and D2 are independent. In a second example, we looked at D1 and the sum of D1 plus D2, which we called Y. In this case, we obtain a similar PMF, but with a different range. Intuitively, we can guess that these two random variables are not independent. To prove this, we can first marginalize over D1 and Y to obtain the two marginals, which are the PMFs of D1 and the PMF of Y. Now suppose we want to calculate the probability of D1 being equal to 4 and of Y being equal to 5. Through the joint PMF, we know that this probability is equal to 1 over 36. But if now we try to obtain this probability by simply multiplying the two marginals, we will obtain a value that is different from 1 over 36. And this is because clearly D1 and Y are not independent. When we discussed random variables, we used expected value and moments to provide a statistical description of the random variable. Now we can extend the same concepts to random vectors. While the expected value for a single random variable was a number, which we called the mean, the expected value of a random vector is also a vector and is represented by the means of each random variable. While for a single random variable we used the variance to describe the spread of the random variable, for pairs of random variables we use the covariance to describe the correlation between the two different variables. This is obtained by taking the expectation of the product between the two variables after subtracting for their mean. To understand the concept of covariance, we can look at an example. Here we simulate two continuous random variables which are identically distributed as a normal or Gaussian distribution, with mean 0 and variance 1. If we look at the scatter plot, we obtain a bidimensional Gaussian distribution. When we look at the histograms of the two marginals, we indeed see that x1 and x2 are identically distributed because they have the same PDF. However, if we repeat the simulation for a different joint probability model, we see that the scatter plot changes, but when we look at the two marginals, the single random variables are distributed the same as before. And when we look at the two simulations next to each other, we can better appreciate that although the two marginals are the same, the joint PDF are indeed different. The reason why the two scatter plots are different is because in the two cases, x1 and x2 have different covariance. The covariance can also be rewritten through simple mathematical passages as the expected value of the product between the two random variables minus the product of their means. The expected value of the product of the two random variables is also known as correlation. Although it might be a bit confusing, two random variables are said to be uncorrelated when their covariance is zero, while they are said to be orthogonal if their correlation is zero. Another useful statistic is the correlation coefficient, which is used to express the correlation between two random variables independently from their variance. This is basically obtained by normalizing the covariance by the standard deviation of the single random variables. And because of this normalization, the correlation coefficient is always bounded between minus 1 and 1. To understand why the correlation coefficient can be useful, let us look at an example. Suppose we perform measurements of the force generated by different masses thrown at different accelerations. We are given two sets of experimental data coming from two different labs, and we visualize the two datasets by scatter plots of the mass against the force. Looking at these plots, we infer that for both cases, not surprisingly, there is a positive correlation between the two variables mass and force. But strangely, the relationship looks different. And when we calculate the covariance, we also obtain a rather different number, while the correlation coefficient is very similar. The reason why the scatter plots look so different is because the first experiment was performed somewhere in Europe, where the international system is used, So the mass was measured in kilograms and the force in Newton, while the second experiment was performed in the United States, where the mass was reported in pounds and the force in pound force. This example shows one reason why the correlation coefficient can give a better insight on the correlation between two variables, while the covariance is dependent on both the spread and the units of measurement of the two random variables. Finally, we can extend the concept of covariance to random vectors. In this case, we no longer have a single value, but a matrix. The value for row n and column m of this matrix is simply the covariance between random variable xn and random variable ym. As a result, the covariance matrix is symmetric. A special case is when x equals y, in which case we talk about autocovariance matrix. If the covariance matrix is equal to 0, x and y are uncorrelated. Very similarly, we can obtain the cross-correlation matrix, where each element is the correlation between xn and ym. In case x equals y, we talk about autocorrelation matrix, and if the cross-correlation matrix is equal to 0, x and y are said to be orthogonal. This concludes this screencast in which we introduce random vectors, and we also extended the concept of independence to probability models, and finally we described the statistical characterization of multiple random variables. Thank you for listening.